Creator, the Creator, and that we are your sons and we are your daughters. And I thank you, Father, that you've created us to, in your likeness and in your image, which means you've created us to be part of your creative order. That we can speak your words, that your words create in the atmosphere that which you desire. This is why it is so important, Father God. We know you gave us free will, Father God, but we are going through this process of saying we're not interested on this free will anymore. We give this awesome gift back to you, that our prayers may be perfectly lined with your will, Father God. And then we know that they will happen because it is your very will that we're praying. We're not praying our desires. We're not praying what we need. We don't pray any of these things. We pray a perfect will, Father God. And this evening, Father God, it is, Father God, it is your will, Father, that your people may come into this place and something inside of them be transformed as they begin to hear things about the kingdom that they may have never heard before, Father God. Father, I thank you, Father, that as Yeshua comes to speak, Yeshua ministers to an audience of one. He ministers to the Spirit of the Son that is inside of the hearts of every single person here who's accepted the King of Israel to live in their hearts. So that must increase, and that which is of flesh must decrease, Father God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Father, your word says that it is by your anointing, by your Spirit, that we're led into all truth, Father God. So right now, Father God, we just take our minds and we lay them down, Father God. Our ability to understand with our physical minds, Father God, we lay it down because we're here to understand in spirit, Father God, through the heart, oh God. Through the heart, Father God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, for your amazing calendar, Father God. We thank you that in your understanding there is neither a new nor an old, but you're simply working something. You're working a love story. A love story, Father. You're working out a love story between this awesome thing you created that you fell in love with, that you died for, so that you could not just save, but bring it onto yourself so that you could become one with your bride. We can't understand this in the natural, Father. It's impossible. In the natural, we try to understand these things, and it turns into religion. How can we understand a love so great that you would go beyond dying for us? You went beyond that. You went as far as saying, I fell in love with my creation, and I'm going to take her for my bride. Thank you, Father. Well, Father, this bride is here today. And I thank you that the Spirit is adorning this bride even this day. You have come here as a bride to be adorned, that you may be ready for the bridegroom that is coming soon. 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 Every generation has said he's come soon, but we're the only generation that has all the pieces of the puzzle put together already. Sorry, folks. You came into this atmosphere, you came into this world to usher in the glory of the King of Kings. Get your lips ready. Get ready to pucker up. Get ready for some good loving. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We're in our third week, I believe, of this yeshiva class where we're going to the feast and the festivals of the Lord. Very strong misconception out there. People will say, well, these are the Jewish feasts. They're not the Jewish feasts. These are the feasts of the Lord. These are the feasts of the Lord that the Lord taught the Jewish people. They're not the Jewish feasts, they're the feasts of the Lord. And this is an awesome rehearsal for us to learn because there's a king coming and he's gonna establish a kingdom and he has a calendar and there's gonna be times of celebration and you are being prepared to be the great ones who will live in the kingdom and will be sent out from Zion all over the world to teach the people and the nations how to celebrate the festivals, what these festivals mean, because the scripture says that they're from Zion, saviors will go and bring the good news to the nations, to many in the far ends of the world who don't know about these things. You have been called, not by your own decision, because none of us is here by our own decision. We sort of think it might be, but it isn't. God Himself called you to be alive at this time. God Himself has placed something in your heart for you to be here this evening, to hear things that in your head you'll leave saying, why am I listening to this? But it's something inside of your spirit begins to leave. You cannot contain this spirit of the living God, Yeshua Himself inside of your heart that begins to leap when these truths begin to activate. He eats. The one living in your heart eats meat. He's done drinking milk. He needs to eat meat. And He's sinking His teeth into meat. And He's increasing as we're decreasing. He's increasing as we're decreasing. So it's an awesome thing. What an awesome, awesome thing that Aaron has called us to be here in this evening to learn about the things of the kingdom. This is the third week we're getting together. So at the first week, just a quick recap, we spoke about Passover. Begin to understand how Passover, the Passover lamb, is not just the Passover lamb of the Old Testament. We begin to see the fulfillment of the Passover lamb when Yeshua comes in right on schedule, 10 days, on the 10th day of the month. He comes in, He's received as the king, but there's only one problem. His first coming isn't as a king, it's as a lamb. So we find out also that in the evening of the 14th, exactly in God's calendar, at the same moment that God tells the children of Israel, every house of Israel, the whole nation of Israel must slay the lamb. We find 2,000 years ago in front of the world, in front of the universe, in front of the angels, the entire nation of Israel says, crucify him, crucify him. They don't even know what they're saying, because God takes what the enemy intends for evil and He turns it to good. God takes your hate and turns that to good. God takes your confusion and turns it to good. So we begin to realize God's amazing calendar, and we begin to realize that on the first day of the week, which is when God said, when Yeshua said, let there be light, let there be light, He must rise on the first day for several reasons. Number one, because He only rests on Shabbat, so He had to take a nap and go into Sheol and take some people out of there because He came to set the captive free. But not only that, He can't rest anymore. He can't rest into Sunday, into Monday, because then He'd be breaking His own commandment. He can only rest on Shabbat. It's an amazing thing. So we see at a nice, perfect calendar. And so here we go. We are getting ready and prepared to enter into the third festival of the spring feast. And this is the festival of weeks. Shavuot, and in the church, people understand it or hear it as Pentecost. And they think Pentecost is a new thing that happened. Well, they were simply celebrating a Hebraic festival that was being fulfilled in an amazing way. And this evening, what a blessing that we have Yeshua here to share this very message. Baruch Hashem. Thank you, Father. Hallelujah. Baruch Hashem. Those are probably people in there.
Oh, good. There's a big talent.
That's right.
This is a very warm talit. And that is a blessing to be wearing a warm talit. Okay, everybody here expected Rabbi Peter to teach the class tonight. I want you to shut your eyes.
That's right.
I want you to shut your eyes for those who expected Rabbi Peter to teach the class. And as your eyes are shut, I want you to make a mental note, and even a note in your spirit, that I did not come here to hear any human teach any class. I have come here to hear Yeshua teach a class. So I will not focus on any vessel, although we may share a talit tonight.
That's right.
I will not focus on the vessel. I'm going to open my eyes and I'm going to say, oh, Yeshua is teaching this class. Baruch Hashem, that is why I came here tonight.
Hallelujah.
All right, you may open your eyes. say this myself, okay? And even as the quote-unquote teacher, I say to myself that I am really, Brian is sitting with you. I'm sitting with you. Yeshua is teaching the class, and I'm here to be ministered to by Adonai and by His Spirit, just like you are. Just like you are. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Well, Baruch Hashem. I don't know why I'm Yeshua in this vessel, me, is always being asked to teach this Shavuot class. I don't understand it. I know that a couple of years ago at a congregation I used to go to, I felt Adonai talking to me a lot about Shavuot and writing down all the stuff about Shavuot. And then at my old congregation that I went to in New Jersey, I wound up teaching a class on Shavuot. Right? And Baruch Hashem, I think it was about like two people in the audience. Right? But that's okay because there's really an audience of one. So Yeshua is one, and as many people as one. Many, many sons of God is one, as one. So anyway, but in the natural there were two.
I was one of them.
Yeah. I don't even know if you were. So anyway, I had all this stuff like on my laptop, and when Rabbi Peter was first giving these classes on the Moedim, that means the appointed times, the festivals of the Lord. He was up to Shavuot, and I don't know what happened. Something zapped in the spirit. He asked me to do it. I said, well, I happen to have a Shavuot teaching. He said, Baruch Hashem, go for it. Right? And that's the way it's been unto this day as we go through these classes. So, well, praise Adonai. I'm here to be ministered to by the Spirit of Adonai, just as you are. So, before we start going into Shavuot, Rabbi Peter did say that Shavuot is Pentecost. I mean, how many of you who came here heard the term Shavuot? Okay. How many of you not heard the term Shavuot? It's okay to raise your hand. Okay, Baruch Hashem. How many of you have heard the term Pentecost? Pretty much everybody, right? It's another reason why I have no idea why I'm teaching this class. I do not speak in tongues. You think that somebody's going to teach you about Pentecost, at least you speak in tongues. I do not speak in tongues, so I don't know what the heck I'm doing teaching this class. So, that is why Yeshua is teaching the class. Yeshua is teaching the class. Alright, so as a refresher, so our spirits can focus in on what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the congregation. It says in the book of Revelation, hear what the Spirit of the Lord is saying to the congregation. So pray Adonai that you open our ears to hear what you are saying today. You are saying today, Adonai. We come here to hear a class. Even I have pieces of paper with notes, with ink. Adonai, all these things are temporal and is dust. Is dust. Adonai. Teach us beyond what is on any piece of paper, and teach us beyond anything what anybody knows, Adonai.
Yes.
By your Spirit, teach us, Adonai. By your Spirit. Even so, Adonai. Even so, on this night, Adonai, as we seek to draw closer to you, Adonai, and learn about the festivals of Adonai, the festivals of the Lord, draw us closer to you. In Yeshua's name. Amen. All right. Off we go. All right, flashback. We start with a flashback. The year is 32 AD. It is 32 in the Common Era, the year of our Lord, as some say, is the year 32. It is a Thursday night. The land is Israel. Of course, back then they called it, not Palestine, there was a word for Palestinia or Philistinia or something like that. But we know it is the land of Israel on this Thursday night. It was in springtime. It was almost 2 weeks, in fact, into springtime. Barley is popping up around the land of Israel. It's popping up. So something unique about the barley, though, although it's popping up, nobody yet was picking the barley. It was coming up, and it was a sign. It was a sign to the children of Israel that spring is here, winter has passed, spring has arrived, and we're entering into a new season. Everybody have a garden? And you know that, for those who have a garden and plant bulbs, know that the first flower, or one of the first flowers that come up is the crocus.
Yes.
Right? And you see the crocus come up, and often it's still snowing when the crocus comes up. But what the crocus is, it's a sign to the people that winter is ending and spring is here. Spring is drawing near. So it comes up even through the snow. And sometimes it actually gets choked out by the snow and will actually die. But it will not die before singing its song to the people that spring is coming. These cold, dark days are ending and spring is here. And that's sort of like Yeshua, isn't he? He's like that crocus who comes in a dark time, right? Gets choked out by the darkness of the time. But through his death of being frozen in the snow, he's singing, spring is coming, spring is coming. So back in the land of Israel, it is a Thursday night. Thursday night, it is springtime, like I said. It is a special Thursday night in spring. People aren't just tiptoeing through the tulips. It is a special Thursday night on this spring day in the land of Israel in the year 32. The reason why it is such a special day is because the next day, on Friday, at sundown, starts the festival or the day of Passover. Okay? So at sundown, here's sundown. Sundown. This is when, on Friday, this is when Passover begins. So there's a lot of stuff going on today on this Thursday night, on this Thursday. There's a lot going on because this is a very special day, and that makes today, Thursday, preparation day. It is preparation day for the Passover. And what is being prepared here? Well, already, as we heard, everybody has a lamb already in their homes. It's a perfect and spotless and blameless lamb. For any other lamb would not be acceptable as the Passover sacrifice to slay on Passover. And to remind us of what happened at the first Passover in the Exodus, when a perfect lamb was slain, and the blood of that lamb was spread on the doorposts of the homes of the Israelites. So the angel of death would pass over and not affect the children of Israel that were in those homes. It had to be a perfect, perfect Passover lamb. But those lambs were ready in the house, and there's something else going on because the next day is Passover. Because a couple of things need to happen before this time. Okay, a couple of things need to happen. So just before sundown, there's a few things that happen. One, that Passover lamb is slain before sundown. Number two, all leaven needs to be removed from all the houses in all of Israel. All the leaven needs to be removed. Then comes sundown. And all the leaven is gone. And everybody in every house in the land of Israel are searching for leaven. And they eventually get to a place where they say, this house is clean. Right? That's not a reference to Poltergeist. That is a reference to... that is a reference to the house being cleaned from leaven. All leaven, at this point, before sundown, is removed from every house within the land of Israel. The lamb is slain. Then comes sundown, and then comes the Passover Seder. Everybody know what the Passover Seder is? It is a customary Passover meal. Its roots are in the Bible, where it says in the book of Exodus that you're to eat certain food elements. You're supposed to eat bitter herbs to remind us of the bitterness of slavery. You're supposed to eat unleavened bread, right? And there's other things. And lamb. You're supposed to eat lamb. Right? And it all comes from this verse in Exodus where it says, when your children ask you, what happened? What happened back then? And why are we doing all these things on this night? You have to tell them. You have to tell them. So that's why there's this meal that happens with everybody around the table. The whole purpose of the meal is to fulfill that command of telling the children when they ask, why are we doing all this stuff? It's to tell them why, and to tell them the miraculous exodus that Adonai has given us. We've marched out of slavery into freedom. So this happens here after sundown. So back here today, on this Thursday, it is a very busy day. Like I said, it's not just your typical spring day. It is very busy. Everybody is searching for leaven. We only have about 24 hours left, and all the leaven in all the homes have to be removed. This is happening in all the houses in all of Israel. There is one house, however, in the land of Israel where there is something unique happening on this Thursday night. And on this Thursday night, in one house in Israel, somewhere in Israel, in an upper room, there is a Seder going on one night early. Why, in one house, would there be a Seder going on one night early when it's supposed to happen after sundown on Friday, after Passover begins? The reason is that the person on this Thursday night who was running this Seder knows that he will not survive the next day. He will not survive this event of the slaying of the Passover lamb. So he must have his Seder here. And even so, he says to his disciples, how I long to keep the Passover with you before I suffer. That person is Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus the Messiah, having his Seder here. Amen?
Amen.
With me? Okay. So this is happening when all over Israel, people are searching for leaven. Later on in Scripture, in a piece of Scripture that was not yet written when Yeshua walked the earth, it speaks very clearly about what leaven represents. And leaven, according to Scripture, represents sin. Right? It puffs things up. It represents pride. It represents sin. Right? Paul speaks about how leaven represents sin. So all over Israel, people are searching for leaven to remove. Right? But that, in the spirit, that means they're looking for sin to remove. They're looking for sin to remove. And at this time, the leaders in Israel are looking for Yeshua. As everybody in Israel is looking for leaven to remove from their houses, the leaders in Israel are searching for Yeshua to remove him from Israel, for they considered him like leaven, like sin. But Adonai has an amazing way of answering prayers, doesn't he? And you better contemplate what you're asking of Adonai, because he will answer you. But maybe not in the way that you actually anticipate. So the Jewish leadership wanted Yeshua's execution to be done with and taken over, be done with before sundown, because that was the Passover. He thought that if it went on into the festival, there'd be a riot, the people would be really unhappy, so let's get this thing over with. Right? So he was found, Yeshua was found, and we know the story. He was taken, he went through the trial, he was brought before Pilate, he was beaten. That went through all the night, and there he is on Friday on the cross. On the cross. All throughout Israel, it is time for the lambs to be slain. Everybody in all the houses who brought their spotless lambs to be slain, it is being slain at that exact same time that it's happening across Israel where lambs are being slain. Yeshua is on the cross. The Passover lamb is on the cross at the same time the lambs are being slain. At the same time, leaven is removed from homes. Listen to this. At the same time that leaven is removed from homes, when people in every home is saying, this house is clean, this house
is clean. This house is clean. Yeshua is on the cross and he says, it is finished. It is finished. At the same time that people are saying, this house is clean from leaven. Leaven is now removed from Israel. And that Jewish leadership wanted Yeshua removed. So Adonai says, okay, I will hear that. So he takes all the leaven in Israel and he places it on Yeshua. And Yeshua takes all the leaven from all of Israel and goes outside of the camp and takes it upon himself so Israel can be unleavened, sinless. And he says, this house is clean because I've taken the leaven from every house and I've put it on myself. Why else is Passover followed by the festival of unleavened bread? Why else? Because Yeshua took all the leaven, exactly what the leadership wanted. He's leaven. Get rid of him. So he said, Baruch Hashem, I will be considered leaven on behalf of you. And I will take all your leaven and I will bring it outside the camp. And when you say this house is clean, surely it will be clean.
Hallelujah.
It will be nothing else. Hallelujah. Baruch Hashem. And yes, it is followed by 7 days of unleavened bread. Seven is like a number of completeness in the Bible. Complete, 7 days of unleavened bread means complete sinlessness.
That's right.
That's what it means. That's what it means. So this is what happened on this Thursday to Friday in the year 32, in the spring, in the land of Israel. Thus, Yeshua fulfilled Passover.
Amen.
Thus, Yeshua fulfilled Passover and started this crazy tradition, this crazy pattern of him fulfilling the Torah. And fulfilling all the Jewish holidays, all the festivals of the Lord. All of them. He is the fulfillment of all of them. And this was the beginning of that pattern. The disciples did not know this at this time. They didn't go, you know, they should have looked at him on the cross and looked at lambs being slain all throughout Israel and went, That's what they should have done. They were too scared to do that. They were bolting all over the place. Okay? So Yeshua fulfilled Passover. The first of the Moedim. The beautiful thing about the Hebrew word Moedim is that it does not mean holiday. It means appointments. Appointments. So that is the Hebrew word for the holidays, for the festivals. Moedim. Can we say Moedim?
Moedim.
Moedim. Okay. It means appointments, right? Even doctors can miss appointments. Adonai, the greatest physician, does not miss his appointments. This is why we did not need something called Good Friday to commemorate this day. It was already good before somebody said, this is Good Friday. It was already good. In fact, calling it Good Friday and not recognizing that this actually happened on
Passover, on Pesach, is doing something to Jewish people, my ancestors, my family, and people around the world. It's doing this to Jewish people. It's blinding them from seeing Yeshua. Because everything that we just spoke about, how Yeshua was executed at the exact same time that lambs are being slain across Israel, is Jewish people do not know that. Because it didn't happen on Passover, it's Good Friday. Right? There's no reason to connect what he did and the removal of leaven from Israel when it's just Good Friday. There's no reason to connect it. So, but Adonai has this all under control. Right? And it's so easy, you know, it's so easy for, I have to say, for even Messianic Jews to look at Christians and say, damn it, those freaking Christians. Look at what they did. They took away Passover and they called it Good Friday. It's really easy to do that. This is like this stupid human nature thing that does not deserve to be walking on the earth. It deserves to be in hell where Yeshua brought it. Right? That whole type of thing actually started with the Jewish people. When Israel was split and you had the northern tribes and the southern tribes, the people in the northern tribes did this. They were the first to do this. People were like, oh, the Christians, they changed all the law. No, it was the Jewish people who changed the law first. If you read the scriptures, it was the ones that went to the northern tribes. They changed everything. They changed the calendars. They changed who can be a priest. Anybody can be a priest. They changed all this stuff. So that all came from us. The Christians just did a really good job. I think they globalized it. So Yeshua fulfilled Passover, and he started the process of bringing messianic redemption to the world and fulfilling all the different moedim. First came Passover, unleavened bread. He is the fulfillment of unleavened bread. He is sinless, and he brought sinlessness to us. Amen. So we continue. We continue past Passover to the next holiday. And the next holiday in the biblical cycle is called First Fruits. It's not called Easter. Isn't Easter the next holiday after that? Well, actually, Leviticus 23 is the chapter in Scripture which speaks of all the Moedim, all the appointed times, the appointed festivals of the Lord. It's all in Leviticus 23. It lists them all. And if I remember correctly, it actually starts with the Sabbath. The first, really, of all the appointed times, right? What the beautiful thing is, the book of Hebrews really talks about the greatest of the appointed times, and that is today. Today. For today, if you hear the voice of the Lord, it is a moedim between you and Adonai at this particular moment. And harden not your hearts if he is speaking, because that is an appointment just for you and him. So Leviticus 23 speaks about all the Moedim. Verse 5 through 8 is about Passover, but it continues on, and I'll read it in my notes. It says, starting in verse 9, this is Leviticus 23. Then Adonai spoke to Moses, saying, speak to the sons of Israel, and say to them, when you enter the land which I am going to give you to reap its harvest, then you shall bring in the Omer from the first fruits of your harvest to the priest. Well, what is an Omer? It's not Homer Simpson. An Omer is a unit of measure. Like in Sesame Street, I think it said like a container of milk, a stick of butter, and a loaf of bread. Everybody remember that from Sesame Street? I do. You know, you have a gallon of milk. Like the unit of measure is the gallon, right? An omer is a unit of measure that measures grain. So it's an omer of grain. So I'll read that again. And this is, I'm reading after Passover. So Leviticus 23 goes through all the different Moedim, festivals of the Lord. It goes through Passover, and what I'm reading now is after Passover. All right, we just went through Passover, and I'm reading after Passover. So I'll read again. When you enter the land which I'm going to give you to reap its harvest, you shall bring in the omer, which is a measure of wheat, a measure of barley, from the first fruits of your harvest to the priest. So you give this first fruits of the barley to the priest. Right? So now the priest has it. He shall wave the omer before Adonai for you to be accepted. Listen to this. Listen to this. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. I'll read that again. On the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave it. On the day after the Sabbath. Now remember, it was before. It was when spring first began where the barley started to pop up. It started to pop up. But as I said, it wasn't being touched. It was not touched. It was not ready yet for touching. It wasn't ready for harvest. It was there, but it wasn't ready yet. It is on this day after the Sabbath, after Passover, right? We just went through Passover. Now it says, on the day after the Sabbath, the priest shall wave this omer of barley, right? This is a day in the Torah, in the scriptures, that commemorates resurrection. Resurrection. Because what it's commemorating is that, like I said, the winter is over, right? The barley is coming up. And it is on this day, you were not allowed to eat the barley from this new crop that was coming up until this day, the day after the Sabbath. Day after Sabbath. I guess it's a good reason why the Lord in this scripture spoke about the Sabbath first, before he said, you're going to do something on the day after the Sabbath. So we clarify what the Sabbath is. So the Sabbath is the seventh day of week, according to scripture. It's what we call Saturday. That's the Sabbath. So the day after the Sabbath is what day?
Sunday.
Sunday. And this is after Passover. So what is happening here on the Sunday after Passover?
Resurrection.
Yes. The crops that are just up is plucked out of the ground. And it is waved before Adonai. It is waved. And that the children of Israel has been doing year after year after year after year, commemorating resurrection of these crops. That once it was dry and it was barren, but on this day after the Sabbath, after Passover, they say, yes, Adonai has resurrected what was once dead, is now alive again. Adonai puts his truth in nature all over the place. All over the place. I was just looking at the fall foliage a couple weeks ago, and I was amazed on how beautiful these leaves are just before death. It's very, very beautiful. Adonai puts his reality and truth into nature all over the place. In fact, many of these holidays, when you're reading in the scriptures, it's very much about nature. It's very much about harvest. In its raw meaning, like the literal meaning, it's very much about harvest. Right? It's about crops coming in, and you reap it, and you're sowing, and all these types of things. So there's a wonderful, wonderful truth and revelation just within nature. So here it is on this day where the crops are being picked and they are being waved. This is the day that Yeshua comes out of the grave. This is the day that Yeshua comes out of the grave. The day after the Sabbath, after Passover. And again, we didn't need Easter for that. We didn't need it. And again, it does a little bit to the Jewish people. It does a little bit of blinding to the Jewish people. But Adonai again has it all under control. Because Paul said he put everybody under sin.
That's right.
Everybody. So he will be glorified at the end. So he will be glorified. So he can show grace to everyone. Everyone. So this is the day after Sabbath, that Yeshua was resurrected. And I find it amazing that until this day, you were not allowed to touch the crops. They were there, but you weren't allowed to eat them. They were untouchable. And there was this time when Yeshua was resurrected, when it was Mary. Said, you know, it was like, oh, Lord, right? Said, don't touch me. I haven't gone yet, ascended to the Father. Well, you think that maybe that means like you weren't allowed to touch him until 40 days after when he ascended to the Father? We know that's not the case because when he was with his disciples in the room, he actually encouraged people, touch, touch. Right? So it wasn't that we had to wait until he was taken up, but there was something about this time that he wasn't yet allowed to be touched. And I don't fully get it, but I know there's a connection when there's these crops that are not allowed to be touched until this day when the priest waves the crop before the Lord. And at this point, the crops, we've entered into another time. We've entered into another dimension or just another phase, right? Where all of the old is gone, and now the new. We are in the time of the new. Time of the new. The Lord said in the book of Jeremiah, behold, I make a new covenant in the house of Israel. Right? And this is the time when you're allowed to eat the first fruits of the harvest. Thus, Yeshua fulfilled the day of first fruits. The disciples must have been seeing a little bit of a pattern here. At some point, they were like, wait a minute. I'm seeing something here. And Yeshua was with the disciples for 40 days. He was teaching them. And it must have been very amazing what Yeshua was teaching the disciples during that time when he was on earth. But even that time was an appointed time. For it says in Scripture, and I'm going to continue to read this. This is still from Leviticus 23. You shall count for yourselves from the day after the Sabbath. So that's the day of Yeshua's resurrection, the day after the Sabbath. From the day when you brought in the Omer for the wave offering, you shall count 7 complete Sabbaths. You shall count 50 days to the day after the 7th Sabbath. Then you shall present a new grain offering to Adonai. So from this day after the Sabbath, you are to count. This is what it says in Scripture here in the same Leviticus 23. Count. This is one day. This is day 2. This is day 3. This is day 4. Count the days. Count the days. This is the time that Yeshua was on earth after his resurrection. This was the time leading up to Pentecost when he was on the earth. This was the time when Scripture says, count the days. Count the days. And it was always a time of great expectation. Always a time of great expectation. According in Jewish tradition, they believe that counting is the time between the Exodus and the time when the Torah was given, the law was given at Mount Sinai. It's always a time of expectation. It's always a time of expectation. And this is the time that Yeshua was walking on earth. When the scriptures say to count 40 days, to count 50 days, excuse me. Yeshua was on earth. Thank you, Adonai. Adonai is so amazing. He's so amazing. He puts wonderful, wonderful realities in Scripture. If we, by His grace, can see through the letters, can see through those letters of the law, into the realities that He has in His Torah, in His Bible, there's wonderful resurrection. There's resurrection on the pages. There's resurrection in those pages. Just waiting to be found. There's like little barley there. Right? That's waiting to be eaten. It's waiting to be harvested. It's waiting to be harvested. And if we, Adonai, just grace us, Adonai. Grace us with the ability to see barley in the pages of Scripture that for so long has been kind of kept shut as the old. We know, Adonai, that there is new. We know, Adonai, that there is new. But there is revelation in the old. In the old. That speaks of the one who makes all things new. Amen. This time of the 50 days that we're counting from the day of his resurrection, the day when the first grain was waved before Adonai, that whole season is called the season of first fruits. It is called first fruits the whole time, right? And the Hebrew word for that is bikurim. That may be a little bit of a tongue twister. Can anybody say bikurim? And no, we're not bikurim. We say bikurim. But it's bikurim, right, bikurim. Means first fruits. And this is the time of the first fruits. And in the natural, I mean, you're seeing the grains pop up, right? And those, that's the first fruit of the grain. And we know that Yeshua is the first fruits. It says in 1 Corinthians, Messiah has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. What did Paul mean when he said that? Paul knew as a rabbi that there is a connection to these things that we're talking about here. He knew. He knew at this point that Yeshua was the fulfillment of these things. Yeah. He knew it. The disciples may not have known it right when they were scattering. But Paul, when he wrote that, he knew. He knew the connection. He knew the connection that Yeshua is the first fruits. Yeshua is the first fruits. Yeshua is the first fruits. Any questions at this point? How's everybody doing? Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem. All right, what next? Let's see. Thank you, Abinai. Thank you, Abinai. Oh yeah, Shavuot. We were going to talk about Pentecost, weren't we? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Okay, so we have the day that Yeshua was resurrected. On the day when the grain was plucked and was weighed, that is the day. That is the day. The greatest day that Yeshua was resurrected. Then we count 50 days. That's what it says in Scripture, to count 50 days. What happens at the end of the 50 days? The end of the 50 days is the festival of Shavuot. At the end of the 50 days comes Shavuot. And Shavuot, according to our people, is the day that the Lord put his foot on Mount Sinai and came down and spoke the Ten Commandments to the people. This is the day of Shavuot, okay? The word Shavuot, is there an eraser?
There's Lysol.
And there are tissues. Shavuot. Shavuot means weeks. The Hebrew word Shavuot means weeks. So the festival of Shavuot is the festival of weeks. Why is it called weeks? Because the Lord just got finished telling us that we are to count 7 weeks after the day that we wave the Omer. So from the day we wave the Omer, we count 7 weeks, and we get then to the festival of weeks, which is Shavuot, the festival of weeks. And again, this is the day that the Jewish people commemorate as the day when the Lord came down on Mount Sinai and spoke to the people. Thank you, Yeshua. I'm going to read from the book of Exodus, which speaks about when the Lord set foot on Mount Sinai and spoke to the people. This is from Exodus 19. Now, it says this happened in the third month in Exodus 19, and 50 days after Passover is in the third month. It always falls in the third month. Okay, because Passover is in the first month, and 50 days after, it is in the third month. So it says in Exodus 19, verses 16 to 20, "Then it came to pass on the third day, in the morning, that there were thunderings and lightnings." I want you to shut your eyes as you listen to this. Okay? "It came to pass on the third day in the morning that there was thunderings and lightnings." Visualize this. and a thick cloud on the mountain. And the sound of the trumpet was very loud, so all the people who were in the camp trembled. This was scary. This was frightening. All the people were around the mountain, and they're hearing the sounds of a very loud trumpet, shofar blasts. There's cloud on the mountains. There was thunder. There was lightning. This was scary, man. They were trembling in their boots. And Moses brought the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Now Mount Sinai was completely in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the mountain quaked greatly. How do we simulate this? This was just the craziness. This was crazy. They're at the mountain, and if you read before this, the Lord told the people, cleanse yourselves. Just be clean. Cleanse yourself. Because something's happening in 3 days that is very, very holy. And the fear of the Lord will be in you when you experience what you're going to experience. So cleanse yourselves right now. Cleanse yourselves. And don't touch. Don't touch the mountain. Because the Lord is descending upon the mountain. Now, Mount Sinai was completely in smoke because the Lord descended upon it in fire. Its smoke ascended like the smoke of a furnace, and the whole mountain quaked greatly. And when the blast of the trumpet sounded long and became louder and louder, Moses spoke, and God answered him by voice. And the Lord came down upon Mount Sinai on the top of the mountain. So through all of this thunder and lightning and shofar blasts and cloud and trembling and earthquake, the Lord then spoke. The Lord then spoke through it. And that actually is what's happened on Shavuot. That is what Shavuot commemorates. That the Lord, the maker of heaven and earth, stepped down on his footstool, earth, and spoke. And the people heard the voice, the audible voice of God. And that is what happened on Shavuot. They heard the voice of God. So we go now, from this time, we go into the future. And the children of Israel, year after year, are celebrating this day, 50 days after Biblical Resurrection Day, they are celebrating when the Lord spoke. When he came down from heaven and spoke his words to the people on this day. And year after year, the children of Israel are celebrating this and keeping this and not forgetting it. Not forgetting it. Talking about it. They're studying it. They're not forgetting it. Year after year after year. But this is not something just to do year after year when the great physician is not keeping his appointments. He has an appointment to keep on this day at his perfect, perfect time. And the children of Israel are the ones that they're keeping it, keeping that appointment and catching up to the time when Adonai is about to do a new thing, a new thing. Because Yeshua is the fulfillment of all these things. And Yeshua, as we said, is doing a new thing. That's what first fruits is all about. It's about new. It's about getting rid of the old. The old has passed away. Behold, the old has passed away. And behold, behold, he makes all things new. And that is first fruits. That is first fruits. And at the culmination of this time of first fruits, God came down to earth and spoke. And we're now going to go to the fulfillment of that at Pentecost. And we just got through this reading what happened at Sinai. We just got through reading what happened at Sinai when God came down on the mountain and all these signs were happening. All these signs were happening. Acts 2. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Ruach HaKodesh and began to speak in tongues as the Ruach enabled them. Ruach is the Hebrew word for spirit. Ruach. Now there were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation. According to Judaism, there were men from every nation at the mountain. They came to hear, the ones who had ears to hear were there to hear the voice of the Lord on that day. And here it is 2,000 years ago. There were Jews living in Jerusalem, devout men from every nation under heaven, and when the sound occurred, the crowd came together and were bewildered because each one of them was hearing them speak in his own language. So what happened here? What is the connection? What is the connection? The connection is this is the day that God speaks. This is the day that God speaks. But God does not want to just speak to us from that place to make our knees buckle. That is the God we serve, but that is also not the God we serve. The God we serve dwells among us. Dwells among us. So when this all happened on the day of Pentecost, right, in Acts 2, where the people that were there were seeing these tongues of fire going around and landing on people, and then people were speaking in tongues, and Jewish people were witnessing this, I want to read you some things, right? And when I first found this, this blew me away. Blew me away. Okay, we know that Jewish people have been keeping this festival of Shavuot as a commemoration of this time when God went on the mountain and spoke, right? Now, us Jewish people, we have a way of like, not only of writing down like everything, right? Like every tradition that that people have spoken, anything that a rabbi spoke about is something specific, it's worthy of writing down, worthy of study. Okay, that's what happens in Judaism. And a lot of stuff made it through the years. So I'm going to read you some things from Jewish tradition, some Jewish traditional writings. Okay, I'm going to read you some stuff. This is similar to like reading something from the church fathers, right? Something that a man wrote that is worthy of being read. Okay? So this is from a book called The Jewish Midrash, right? And this is from Judaism. I tell you that this was written, and this type of story predates the book of Acts. Predates the book of Acts. God's voice, as it was uttered, this is talking about when God came down on Mount Sinai, like we just spoke about. God's voice, as it was uttered, split into 70 voices, into 70 tongues, so that all the nations should understand. This is in Jewish tradition. This is what Jewish people talk about, and this is how they, this is what they're studying when it comes to this holiday, this festival of Shavuot, this Feast of Weeks. They are talking about God coming down on the mountain and his voice splitting into tongues and landing on people. It continues. I'm going to read. On the occasion of the giving of the Torah, the children of Israel not only heard Adonai's voice, but actually saw the sound waves as they emerged from Adonai's mouth. They visualized them as a fiery substance. Each commandment that left Adonai's mouth traveled around the entire camp and then to each Jew individually, asking him, do you accept upon yourself this commandment with all the laws pertaining to it? And every Jew answered yes after each commandment. And finally, the fiery substance, the fiery tongue, which they saw, engraved itself, whack, on the tablets. Is that crazy? Is that wild? Yeah. This is what Jewish people are studying. This is what they believe. I mean, it's not in the Bible, but something in my spirit says that this is true. true. That something like this, you know, could be anointed? The person who wrote this down?
Oh, don't go there.
All I can tell you is this. This is what Jewish people have written down long before the book of Acts. That when God stepped foot on the mountain and his voice spoke, the voice split into tongues. The children of Israel saw the tongues as fiery sound waves, and it landed on each individual. This is what the Jewish people were studying. And here it is, in the fulfillment of time, the perfect fulfillment of time, on Shavuot, 50 days after Yeshua, the first fruits, first of the resurrection, was waved up to Adonai. So all the barley can now be eaten.
Amen.
And that, all that barley, that's us.
Amen.
That's us. Maybe we'd be the first fruits, but we're the second fruits. So here it is, 50 days after that, on the day that is commemorated for Adonai coming down and speaking to the people. The Spirit of Adonai has come down and is enabled through the same fiery tongues, the people, the believers, the body of Messiah, to speak God's voice. For back in the days of Sinai, God spoke on the mountain, and the people were like this. Because it was all this pomp and circumstance, for lack of a better word. And a crazy thing happened. Remember when we said that the Jewish people were looking for leaven? And they were looking for Yeshua? Because they considered him leaven? And then Adonai said, okay, I heard your prayer. And then all the leaven went on to Yeshua, and Yeshua took it out of the camp. Right? Adonai has a way of answering prayers. A crazy way of answering prayers. And this is how he answered a certain prayer. On the mountain, it was, like I said, it was very, very frightening to the people of Israel. They were scared to death. Does everyone know the story? They were scared. All this stuff, and they heard God's voice. They heard him speaking the Ten Commandments. And they're like, oh man, we are so dead. We are just dead. It says in Deuteronomy, it actually talks about it. It says, let me not hear again the voice of the Lord my God, nor let me see this great fire anymore, lest I die. This was their reaction to hearing the voice of the Lord. Moses, you go talk to God, and we'll talk to you. That is the reaction of the children of Israel to hearing the voice of God. We don't want to hear it anymore. Now, what do you think God's reaction to that is? Because God has a crazy way of answering prayers. Because when the people of God pray, God answers prayers. And just like I said, we're going to remove the leaven, and God said, amen, Yeshua will remove the leaven. God answered the prayer when they said, we don't want to hear it like that anymore. We don't want to hear it like that anymore. In fact, the Lord said, it says in Scripture, what they have spoken is good. What they have spoken, what does that mean? It's good. Why would that be good? Why would the Lord God, the creator of heaven and earth, the one who breathed and the universe leapt into existence, had just spoken by his own mouth to the children of Israel, and they said, we don't want to hear you ever again. Do not speak to us. We'll talk to this guy. We like the stutterer. That's much safer. But the Lord said, what they have spoken is good. It doesn't make sense. All this time, waiting for this moment to speak the Ten Commandments, and they said, forget it, we don't want to hear it. We don't want to hear you. And he said, what they said is good. That doesn't make sense. But Adonai has a unique way of answering prayers. For he said, I will raise up for them a prophet like you from among their brethren, and I will put my words in his mouth. I will put my words in the mouth of that prophet,
and he shall speak to them all that I command him. So he spoke, but then made a promise that I will put my words, I will raise up a prophet, and I will put my words in the prophet's mouth, and the prophet will speak to you. And the Lord said, just like he did at creation, and that is good. And wouldn't you know it, us crazy ancestors who study and study and study and debate and debate and debate had no idea who the prophet was. Who is this prophet? He's going to raise up a prophet. Okay, is it Moses? Some rabbis think it's Moses. It can't be Moses. Maybe it's Joshua. Maybe he's the prophet because Moses wrote it, so maybe it was somebody after him. Maybe it was Joshua. Maybe it was just the corporate prophet. Maybe it was all the prophets. So this debate, even in the New Testament, right? You see, Yeshua says, who do you say I am? Some say you're the prophet. So who is this prophet? I tell you that it was on the day of Pentecost, on the day of Shavuot, when the answer to who is this prophet was revealed. The answer is that it is you. You are the prophet. The body of Messiah. You are the ones, because it was on this day when the Lord spoke on Sinai. And it was on this day of Shavuot, when the people said, we don't want to hear it. And the Lord said, on that day, he said, this is good what they ask. I will raise up a prophet. And it is on that day when the tongues of fire came from heaven and landed on you, on the believers. And you spoke the words of God on that exact same day through the windows of time. Do you understand that? Windows of time. Let's go back and talk about windows of time. On the day of Passover, when the lamb was slain, on the day when the children of Israel marched out of Egypt, on that day, Yeshua was slain. On that day, it was the same day on Adonai's calendar. It's the same day. We look at time like this, and I'm sure Rabbi Peter spoke about this. We look at time like this, like today, and we got tomorrow, and then we got the next day, right? And over here is yesterday, right? It's like this. The way Adonai works on his calendar is that what's happening on the day on his calendar is happening on that day on the calendar, and independent of the year, because it's a cycle. It's a cycle. So if it looks like this, right, if this was like 1 year, right, this circle, then the next year it looks like this. It's the same cycle. So if this on the cycle is Passover, what happens on this day in 1 year happens on the same day in another year. It's the same day from Adonai's perspective. He doesn't look at time as linear. He is in all time at the same time. He looks at all these days the same. The same. So what happened on Shavuot in 1 year happens on Shavuot in another year. It's the same day from Adonai's point of view. So I tell you that it was on the day when the children of Israel said, we don't want that. And the Lord said, it is good. I will raise up a prophet. From the kingdom's point of view, it was on that day, on Shavuot, on that day, when the believers received the words of God and spoke the fulfillment of Shavuot. But wait a minute. I thought that Yeshua was the fulfillment these holidays.
Oh, wow.
I thought Yeshua was. What are you saying? We are the fulfillment of Shavuot? You just said that Yeshua was the fulfillment of Passover. And you said that Yeshua was the fulfillment of the first fruits, of the first resurrection of the crops. Where is Yeshua? Where is Yeshua on Shavuot? How is Yeshua the fulfillment of Shavuot? When it didn't come on Yeshua, the tongues and everything came on us. We, as Yeshua, as sons of God on this earth, are the fulfillment of Shavuot. We are the fulfillment.
Yeshua is the fulfillment. But we are the body of Yeshua. Right? And this is one of those areas where it's like, whoa, 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 whoa. Right? But I strongly believe that the time is coming when the sons of God will take up their place in, as the body of Messiah. As the body of Messiah. Where the hand won't say to the foot, you're not worthy, when the little toenail, the pinky nail, won't say, I'm not worthy. He'll say, I am the body of Messiah. I am the body of Messiah. I am the body of Messiah. He's just the head. But we are one. We are one with the head. One with the head. And it's so crazy, you know? It's like a teaching. It's tough, man. It's tough. It does say in Scripture that Yeshua did not consider it robbery to be considered equal with God. Everybody know that verse?
Yeah.
The day is coming where the body of Messiah will say, I will not consider it robbery to consider myself
equal
with Yeshua. It's crazy. It sounds like the mother again. It sounds like heresy. It sounds like heresy. But I tell you that Yeshua is looking to make himself known on this earth at this time through the oneness of him the head and him the body. The oneness. Take up your fulfillment. Take up your calling. And take up the fact that you are the fulfillment. Yeshua in you is the fulfillment of Shavuot. That's why the rest of the holidays have not yet been fulfilled. The people of God are still fulfilling this. They haven't gotten it yet. You're still fulfilling unto this day, this holiday, this festival of Shavuot. When God said, I need to raise up a prophet to speak to the people. And therefore has created Messiah with body to walk on this earth, to speak his words. I tell you that Yeshua is he may be the fulfillment of even Passover, the holiday prior. I tell you that I feel that he is the first fruits of the fulfillment of all these things. That the body of Messiah ultimately is the fulfillment of all these things. Ultimately the fulfillment. It is all Yeshua. It is all Yeshua. It is all Yeshua. But we are the collective body of the Messiah. And it is not robbery for the body to be equal with the head. Because Paul said it.
Yes,
don't
Paul
think
said.
That these the body parts should one is greater than the other.
Especially if we've decreased.
Yes, that's right. That's right.
He also put those words on stone. Now they're in our hearts.
Yes, that is exactly right. Yes, that's right. The words he put on stone, he put in our hearts. Mm-hmm. That's right. It's another wonderful revelation in Shavuot when at Sinai, when God spoke, right, Moses stayed up there for 40 days after that whole experience. He stayed up there for 40 days. But because the words of God were being carved on stone at this point and not on heart, the people of Israel, while Moses was up there, they were doing some bad stuff, right? They got real nervous and like, where's Moses? Why is he spending so much time up there? Maybe he's dead. We need another God. Aaron, quick. Here's some jewelry. Okay, fine. Okay. Here you go. Here's a calf. Here's Adonai. He's your God. And the Lord heard that, said, Moses, get down there. Right? And it turned out that on that day, 3,000 people of Israel died on that day. On that day, 3,000 people died. At the culmination of this day at Sinai, when Moses came down, it says 3,000 died. This God of nice, crazy God. He's in the business. existence of resurrection.
Yeah.
Right? For it says in the book of Acts, how many people were saved?
3,000.
3,000 people saved. At Acts 2, on Shavuot, back at Sinai, 3,000 people perished. But at the fullness of time, 3,000 people were saved. Baruch Hashem. Baruch Hashem.
Who's your dad?
Yes. Thank you, Arma. Yes, Shavuot is fulfilled in us, in the body of Messiah. In us as the body of Messiah is the fulfillment of Yeshua, is the fulfillment of Shavuot, is the fulfillment of Shavuot. It is our calling to fulfill this moed, to speak God's words, to speak God's words. We were anointed on this day to speak God's words. That is our calling. That is our calling, to continue to walk among on this earth and fulfill this holiday by speaking the words of God. By speaking the words of God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. It's this one scripture in that Paul speaks about, or I'm not sure where it is. It says that the first fruits are holy, then the rest are holy. And the rest are holy. There's something wrong here in this picture a little bit. Because the children of Israel, you know, in a way, are the first fruits. And it's in Romans 11 when Paul said, when the first fruits are holy, the rest are holy. It's in Romans 11. Romans 11 is the scripture that talks about the olive branches and the olive tree.
Yeah.
Everybody know that? Mm-hmm. When it talks about the natural olive branch. And it talks about the wild olive branches.
Wild man!
And how those wild branches were grafted in to this olive tree that's foreign by nature to these wild olive branches. Right? But it's within those verses where it says that the first fruits are holy, the rest are holy. He says that don't boast against the natural branches. Right? The root supports you.
That's right.
But the first fruits are holy, then the rest are holy. In looking at the first fruits that way, Messiah is the first fruits, as it says. But then it says that the first fruits are holy, the rest are holy. So why hasn't the children of Israel accepted Messiah and become holy as we know holy? Right? There is a time that is coming when the first fruits, and it is now, it's in this day, when the children of Israel, the first fruits, are in the process of becoming holy. Are in the process of becoming holy. There's a scripture that says about the Word of God that God will not send forth His Word, or He will send forth His Word. It will do what it accomplishes, what it's set out to accomplish, and then return up to heaven. Everybody know that scripture? Right? The Word will go forth, and it will not return before accomplishing what it was set to do. And on this, it's in this time when Yeshua, who is the Word, who went forth from Israel to the nations, who will be complete in finishing what He's done in the nations, and will return. The Word will return. And thus all Israel shall be saved. And if the rejection of the Jewish people, or in other translations, if their rejection of Messiah meant salvation for the world, so how much more will their acceptance be from what? But life from the dead. From life from the dead. And on Shavuot, when God's word was put in you to speak, God is in the process of making the first fruits, the children of Israel, holy. 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 There's something about, I'm just going to redirect a little bit, there's something about Passover that spoke to me last week that I want to share with you. We spoke about how on Shavuot, we are the fulfillment. We as the body of Messiah. Messiah, Yeshua, is the fulfillment of Shavuot through His body. Through His body. That's unique. Or is it? We know that Yeshua fulfilled Passover. Right? Yeshua fulfilled Passover. Lamb of God
Mm-hmm. He took the leaven. The day is coming when the body of Messiah will even bring greater fulfillment to that, to the Jewish people, by once again taking on the leaven of the Jewish people. The day is coming when the nations, the non-Jews, people of the nations, will take on the leaven of the Jewish people.
Yes.
So they will be saved. The day is coming. There's something, something that happens every year at Passover. I'm not sure if you're aware of this. But, you know, the Jewish people continue to keep Passover. So before Passover, they're cleaning out leaven. Okay? It still happens every year. Right? Many of us do it. And there's wonderful revelation in doing that. Right? I'm telling you, so many times the Lord spoke to me in my house about removing leaven. He just spoke to me about my own sin. Just from removing leaven. And it's so consistent. I hear it so many times from believers. Like somebody like opening up like their toaster or something sometime during, you know, and seeing all this caked on leaven and like the Lord speaking to them about, you know, their own sin. Or, you know, after you think everything's clean and then you lift up your cushion and there's like a cracker. Right? And the Lord speaks to you about these hidden sins within you. You know, I hear it so often amongst the body of Messiah, those who keep these things. So, the children of Israel keep the Passover, and the children of Israel clean leaven from their houses before Passover. There's something unique that they do, which is something it's easy to take offense at, unless you have ears to hear, which I don't think I did until recently in this one area. This is something the Jewish people do. Every year, this is the religious Jews. They take their leaven and they look for a non-Jew. This is what Jewish people do. To give them their leaven. Say, okay, I'm doing this holiday. I know you don't know anything about it. Okay? But I'm supposed to take all this bread stuff and get rid of it. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to give it to you. I'm going to give it to you, and you can take it, right? And you keep it, right? Because you don't do what I do. I do my thing here, and I need to remove the leaven from my house, so I'm going to give it to you, okay? Christians, they are going to Christians and saying, will you take my leaven? You know, it's so easy to get offended by that as Christians. Wait a minute. Leaven is sin. They're asking me to take their sin. I'm not doing that. They should be like throwing out their leaven or burning it or something. Isn't that more like what you're supposed to do with leaven now that we know that leaven equals sin? Like burn it. Bury it. Give it to the Muslims. No. But here we have it. The Lord is saying to believers, don't you hear it? Don't you see what's happening at this hour? Don't you see it? My people, my Jewish people, they're handing it to you on a silver platter. Revelation. Listen, here is my leaven. I'm asked, this is an Orthodox Jewish person going to Christians saying, will you take my leaven? Right? Take the leaven from the Jewish people and say, Adonai, I will take their leaven as they ask. Because Adonai has a unique way of answering prayers. And don't think that you may not be that answered prayer for that Jewish person who's looking for some goy to take their leaven so their house can be considered clean. So when they come to you, if they do, and say, will you take your leaven? Say, yes, I will take your leaven. In fact, don't even wait for them. Go knock on their doors. Mishkan road trip to Orthodox areas. Knock, knock, knock. I hear that Passover's coming. I hear that you're looking for a Gentile to take the leaven from your house. I will do that for you.
Amen.
I will take your leaven and take the leaven from the Jewish people. And hear what Adonai is saying, how he's looking for people who
who is looking to, who is willing in this hour to take leaven from Jewish people and put it into their house. So Adonai will consider that house clean. And even greater fulfillment than Yeshua on the cross. Crazy. May it be so.
Yes.
They call it the Shabbos Goy. Everybody hear the term the Shabbos Goy? I used to go to a summer camp. It was an Orthodox Jewish summer camp. I don't know why my atheist parents brought me to an Orthodox Jewish summer camp. But I'll never forget this one time. I'll never forget it. True story. I'll never forget this one time. I did not grow up religious at all. Both my parents were atheist, and for much of my life I was atheist. But anyway, I was in summer camp. So I was younger, so I didn't know what an atheist was. I was just a kid. But I certainly didn't have a I certainly didn't grow up learning about God. So I'm at this Orthodox Jewish summer camp for the summer. And I didn't know anything about anything. Right? So I remember we went for like the first, you know, Shabbat, Friday night service, you know, and I'm doing this, and I'm watching people, and I'm like, oh, okay. If they turn the page, I can still turn the page. Okay. Anyway, I was young. So we go back to the bunk, right? It's time to go to sleep. So I go back to the bunk, and I open up the door, and I click on the light switch. Right? Now, in Orthodox, it says in Scripture, you're not allowed to light. Alright, let me back up in case some people go, oh, what's wrong with that? Okay, in Scripture it says you're not allowed to light a fire on Shabbat. On the Sabbath. You're not allowed to light a fire on the Sabbath. Okay? We can go into that, but we won't. But it does say you're not allowed to light a fire on the Sabbath. Religious Jewish people take that extremely literally. That's why they don't drive on the Sabbath, because within the engine there's fire going on. With the spark plugs. Makes a fire. Right? And that is why they also don't light a light switch. Because as simple and small as it is, it creates a spark. So Jewish people do not turn on the lights. So here comes young Brian, not religious, in an Orthodox Jewish camp. I open up the bunk, boink, I turn on the light switch. People start yelling. Who did that? The counselor started screaming, who did that? I was so scared as a kid, I could turn the light off. And of course, I started to cry. But then the rule is I'm supposed to flick it on again, and you bring in the Shabbos Goy, right? I remember coming in, this precious non-Jew told us a little bedtime story about some Gentile story that he had. And he turned off the light for us. How crazy is that? Why would they do that? You know, they don't want to sit up. I mean, let the Gentiles do it. Okay, if you want to be offended, then you can be offended. Right? But I tell you, it is the greatest blessing for a Gentile to be considered, on behalf of a Jewish person, a Shabbos Goy. Mm. To sin. Mm. So the Jewish person does not have to sin. The ultimate fulfillment of Passover. Amen. And I tell you, that is coming. The ultimate fulfillment of Passover that will be fulfilled by the body of Messiah. Mm. And they will recognize him who they have pierced. Mm-hmm. And they will recognize him. Amen.
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 All right. I have to close with this every time. So I'm going to close with it again. And I'm going to get the eraser out. One of the traditions on the festival of Shavuot amongst the Jewish people is they read the book of Ruth. Okay? The reason, there's a couple of reasons that they read, oh, thank you.
Oh, you can say
Yahweh. Okay. So the children of Israel unto this day read the book of Ruth on Shavuot. What is the book of Ruth have to do with Shavuot? There's a few things.
It speaks in the book of Ruth. If I have it here somewhere, maybe I do, maybe I don't. It says somewhere in the book of Ruth that, it's not there, but it says it in somewhere in the book of Ruth, it says it takes place between the barley and the wheat harvest. Okay? And that is the time between the first barley that's waved, the 50 days, and one thing we didn't speak about on that 50th day on Shavuot, that is the wheat harvest. That is the beginning of the wheat harvest. That's the beginning of the wheat harvest. So it says in the book of Ruth that it takes place between the barley and the wheat harvest. So it's during that time, that season of first fruits, that season of Shavuot. That's the time frame of the book of Ruth. That's why it is read on Shavuot. So one of the blessings of reading the scriptures is that we know that God he's deep, man, right? He's deep. He's deep. He's infinitely deep. You read something and you're blessed, but by his grace, if you're able to peel off a layer and you see something, it's amazing. But you didn't get any closer to the depth because it's infinitely deep. So you peel off, by his grace, you peel off another layer, and it's another wonderful revelation, but it's still just as deep. Yeah. You didn't get any closer. And this is humbling for us who feel like we have a revelation about Adonai, and we feel now we're smarter than other people. Okay? Because you are no closer to Adonai than the dummy over here. Right? Who doesn't know anything about Adonai, or maybe just knows this much. Because infinite, even mathematical terms, infinity, like you could be one or you could be at 100 gazillion, yep, and you're still infinite away from infinite. You know? So it's humbling. So when you feel like you have a revelation, you don't know Adonai any more than the person who didn't yet get the revelation. Yeah. We all see through the glass really, really dimly when it comes to Adonai. When it comes to Adonai. We all see through the glass dimly. Right? There's always infinite more of Adonai to experience. Always. So you experience a revelation, you hear truth, you're like, oh, this is amazing. There's an infinite more of our God to discover. Just like the person who didn't get the revelation that by only his grace he got. So, anyway, when you take the book of Ruth and you start to peel off the layers, there's wonderful revelation about just what we're talking about here. About what we're talking about at Shavuot, the body of Messiah, being a blessing to the Jewish people. It's all in the book of Ruth, if by his grace we're able to see through the layers. So we're going to do that, and we're going to close with this. So, here we go. This is always fun. All right, so the book of Ruth starts with a family. Everybody know the book of Ruth? Have you read it? Okay, it starts with a family. Do everybody remember the names in the family? Okay, you have Naomi. In Hebrew, her name is Naomi. That's her name in Hebrew. Naomi, in Hebrew, it's pronounced Naomi. Who is Naomi married to? Elimelech. It starts with Elimelech being married to Naomi. Break it down. What does the word Elimelech mean in Hebrew?
God the King.
Yeah! Eli is my God. Just like Yeshua said, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why have you forsaken me? Eli is my God. King. Melech is king. Elimelech means my God, king. Naomi. In the word Naomi is the word Ami, which means my people. Some people may know the song, you of us may, it's called, or the scriptures. It says in Isaiah 40, comfort, comfort my people. The Hebrew for that is nachamu, comfort, ami. Comfort my people.
comfort my people. I can just say, comfort my people, knock on wood on me, and walk out the door. And that'll be the end of the class. Comfort my people. Okay. So in the beginning, we had Elimelech married to Naomi. Break it down. It means that my God, the king, is married to his people. God is married to his people, Israel, in the beginning of the story. What happens next? Elimelech dies. Is that sacrilegious? Now, we know that God does not die, right? But what it signifies here is a separation between the people of God, Israel. For those who have ears to hear this, Adonai, it was grace to hear this. For those who read Hebrew and understand Hebrew, may Adonai give you the grace to see through this. Adonai. So Elimelech dies. It signifies a separation between God and the people of Israel. Naomi is left alone without her husband. Before he died, of course, they had children. And their children were named Mahlon and Chilion. Mahlon and Chilion. Those are wonderful little boys with wonderful names. Mahlon means sickness. That's what I want to name my kid. But they apparently liked it because they named their other one Chilion, which means wasting away. Both marry Gentiles.
What's wrong with that?
Nothing. I did too. Okay? But listen, when they married Gentiles, these were not people that were within the people of God. Right? These were people sort of outside of the covenant at the time. Right? New covenant terms, you may call it unequally yoked. Let's just leave it at that. Okay? So they marry these Gentile women, and it sort of signifies their place of disobedience. They weren't keeping the ways of God at this point. Okay? In their lifestyle. Right? So they have these kids, sickness and wasting away. The father, the husband, God King, separates from the family. This is a faithful picture of the children of Israel. In fact, Mahlon and Chilion die. Right? In the story? Leaving the people of Israel without their God and without their children. And that's where the story of Ruth opens. A very faithful picture of the children of Israel. In comes the Gentiles. So the two Gentiles that married Mahlon and Chilion, everybody remember their names? There's Orpah. Orpah, someone say Boaz, and Ruth. Yeah. Orpah and Ruth, two Gentiles, right? They are left, so Naomi, my people, is left without their father and husband, God, and without their children. Child is barren, and left with these two Gentiles. Well, these two Gentiles do two very different things, and they represent two different sort of types of Gentiles as there are in the world even today. Orpah turned her back on Naomi. She said, okay, you're not very cool. You're in a place of, sick, wasting away, without God. I don't want anything to do with you. I'm going back to my people, and I'll see you, and I won't let the door hit me in the butt on my way out. Right? Off she goes. That's one type of Gentile. But then there was Ruth, and it says that Ruth clung. Ruth clung. And I believe in this day, these times that we're in right now, there are two types of Gentiles. There are Gentiles that kind of turn their back on widowed Israel and just turn their back. But then, and I believe that God is raising up a generation, a people of non-Jews who will cling to Israel like Ruth clung to Naomi. In fact, Ruth's words to Naomi resonate to this day. It's wonderful, wonderful revelation in Scripture where she says, "Do not urge me to leave you or to turn my back from you. Don't urge me to leave you." Because Naomi was like, "Just go. I'm destitute. I got nothing for you. I'm an old woman. My husband is dead. And I have no children. I'm just alone. Go. It's okay. Go." And Ruth said, "No, I will not leave you. I will not turn my back from you. Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. And where you die, I will die there. And there I will be buried. May Adonai deal with me ever so severely, if anything but death separates me from you." That means no matter what you do, there's only one thing that's going to separate me from you, and that is the day that I die. I don't care if you drop a nuke on your neighbor. I don't care if you take over, build some settlements. I don't care what you do. Because my love for you goes beyond your actions. Because none of it is going to turn me away from you, except my own death. And I will be buried with you when I die. Adonai is raising up roots in this day. He is raising up roots in this day. For he said, if the first fruits are holy, then the rest are holy. And he also said that if their rejection is salvation for the world, then what will their acceptance be but life from the dead? So God is raising up a people to bring all things full circle. Where children of Israel, in part, had blindness and were cast out, and the nations were brought in, and through the nations, Israel will be blessed. The fulfillment of Shavuot. The fulfillment of Shavuot. Ruth is the early fulfillment of Shavuot. The Gentile, the nation who was committed to blessing Israel, to blessing barren, alone, has nobody, Israel. In comes another character. The story continues. And his name is Boaz. He is called what?
Kinsman Redeemer.
Naomi's Kinsman Redeemer. It says he is from the family of Elimelech. The Redeemer. From the family of Elimelech, the Redeemer of Naomi. In he comes into the story, enters into a relationship with Ruth. Enters into a relationship with Ruth, with the Gentile who is clung to Israel. Enters into the relationship with Ruth, the Gentile, who has clung to Israel. Of course, this represents Messiah, the Redeemer, and his Gentile body. Right? I want to share something about Joseph. Joseph was cast out, like Yeshua, by his Jewish brothers. There is a very strong relationship between Yosef, and Yeshua. For Joseph was cast out by his Jewish brothers. Cast out. In fact, they thought he was dead, but he was not dead. Joseph was not dead. Just like Yeshua, when he was cast out, was not really dead. But he became, sort of like Boaz, this ruler. This is Joseph now, right? A ruler over a Gentile nation. He's Jewish. He is a brother of the Jewish people. But he became a ruler over a non-Jewish nation. Doesn't that also sound like Yeshua?
Yes.
The day came in the fullness of time, perfect time, when the children of Israel, there was a famine, and they went to this ruler over Gentiles who looked so much like an Egyptian. He looked like an Egyptian. He was unrecognizable to his Jewish brothers, although that is what he was. He's a Jewish brother. But they went to him in a time of famine. They went to him. And he took off his Egyptian garb and lost it. And introduced himself to his Jewish brothers as who he really is. And the day is coming when the blinders on the eyes of the Jewish people are going to come off, and they will recognize Yeshua, their Jewish brother. And just like Joseph went, Ani Yosef, I am Joseph. Yeshua is going to say, I am Yeshua. I am Yeshua. And in the words of Joseph, what you meant for evil, Adonai has meant for good, to bring about deliverance for Israel. And that is why Adonai sets up these crazy things. How can the Jewish people's rejection of the Messiah lead to their salvation in Messiah? How can their rejection of Messiah lead to their salvation in Messiah? Only our God can do that. Only our God can do that. And he is doing that. He is doing that. And in this day, he's taking these blinders off of the Jewish people, which make the Redeemer, Joseph, Yeshua, look like an Egyptian god. Right? They don't recognize. I know myself, I didn't recognize, you know? I don't recognize Easter. You know, I knew Passover. I knew growing up Passover. But I didn't know what Good Friday was. I didn't know. You know? Jewish people relate to first fruits. But they don't know it. They don't know about Easter. They don't know. So the Yeshua is in this day slowly taking off garments that make him look Egyptian. Is that okay for everyone?
Yeah.
And the Jewish people are recognizing him. They're recognizing him for who he is. And it's only by his grace that even we recognize him for who he is.
That's right.
So anyway, back to Boaz. Boaz is the kinsman redeemer, has a relationship with Ruth. Ruth is the Gentile who clings to Israel. So what happens in this relationship? Ruth goes to glean barley, okay, from the field of Boaz. So she's getting blessings, right? She's getting blessings from Boaz. Boaz has a field, right? Now Boaz represents who?
Yeshua,
Messiah. He's the Redeemer, the kinsman Redeemer. And this Gentile is reaping blessing from the field of Boaz. She's reaping blessing. But the blessing she does not keep for herself. What does she do? She takes all this stuff from the field of Boaz, and what does she do? She brings it to Naomi. That's what she does. She doesn't say, oh, look at all this stuff for me. I'm very special. She takes the blessing that she's gotten from Boaz, and she gives it to Naomi.
she gives it to Naomi, fulfilling, I believe, a calling of the Jewish people.
Of the Gentile people.
Doing the same thing, almost the same thing as what we were talking about, when the Gentile people have the blessing of taking on the leaven of the Jewish people. Same type of thing. She receives blessing from this Redeemer and gives it to Israel, and it does not go unnoticed. Naomi, through this experience, says, "Bless God, that man is our kinsman redeemer." She recognizes him through Ruth blessing her from the blessings that she's received from Boaz. And Naomi is restored. In fact, all the other women, Jewish women, all recognize him as well. It's not just Naomi. She's got her little friends. And they go, "Praise be to God, who in this day has not left you without a kinsman redeemer." So they all recognize him. All of Israel recognizes the Messiah through the blessings that the Gentile has given to Israel. It's crazy. And it restores Naomi. And I tell you this, that the restoration of Naomi is life from the dead. It's life from the dead. It's resurrection. That's what life from the dead is. It's resurrection. That's what Paul meant when he said it's life from the dead. It's resurrection. Right? That is the coming of the Messiah. That is the coming of the Messiah. The coming of the Messiah is Ruth as the body of the Messiah blessing Israel. That is the coming of the Messiah. And again, that is the fulfillment of Shavuot. That is what Shavuot is all about. Receiving the words and the blessings from Messiah, and then taking that and giving it to the Jewish people. And that is what Shavuot is all about. That is what Shavuot is all about. What will their acceptance be, indeed, but life from the dead? Adonai, we ask you, Adonai, to grace us with this. Adonai, because love for Israel, love for the Jewish people is not something that we could just do. Adonai, because in our hearts we do nothing good. Adonai, it is your heart that is good. Adonai. So by your grace, Adonai, by your grace, Adonai, bring restoration to this world, Adonai, and raise us up to our calling as the body of the Messiah. Raise up a generation, Adonai, as the body of Messiah, Adonai, to be the Messiah on this earth, who listens only to the head. May we be, Adonai, body parts that receive signals from the head and do not question where that came from. And just as like my hand can do this when the head tells it to, Adonai, raise up a body that will move and act according to your perfect will and be crazy enough to take the blessings that you gave us, that you enriched us with, and give it to the children of Israel. Freely give. And even grace us with the opportunity to even with one of Naomi's who are still in a place of divorce, fatherless, husbandless, childless, and to say, Adonai, bless me with the ability to take leaven from their house so it'll be counted as their righteousness, Adonai. We ask these things in your name, Adonai, in the name of Yeshua.